Good evening. 4 weeks ago, I began a three-part series of interviews on the question of rape, speaking with the leaders of some of the country's major religions, Swami Aksharananda, representing the Hindus, Maulana Abu Bakr, a resident abroad, and Pastor John Smith and Bishop Francis Aline, Evangelical and Roman Catholic churches, respectively. Today on Plain Talk, we have three women who will respond to some of the issues that arose during those separate interviews and will give their own take on the question of rape within the context of gender, power, violence, etc. And I, Pat Bisnott, Ryhan Shaw, welcome to Plain Talk.
Thank you.
As you probably are aware, the series began as a response partly to the rape in India, that horrible gang rape in India.
It started before, but and then the rape happened.
Yes.
In the midst of the discussion, that okay. rape occurred. Yeah.
When I interviewed these men, they all said it was horrible, it should be condemned. Were you satisfied as women with the degree of condemnation that we saw in Guyana?
In addition to the letters? You mean specifically to the Indian?
The one that happened in India, yes.
I don't think there was much response to what was going on. Actually, the discussion occurred, and I was looking on at it. I was reading what was being said. And it went on for a couple of weeks, and I think it's great that men were airing the issue and talking about rape. But I was expecting one of the women's groups who talk about abuse against women, violence against women, to get into the discussion. And that's after weeks went by, nobody was doing that. I jumped in and to put my two cents worth as a woman. And I think it was after that one group did respond, did send in something, and then they said something like, we were confusing the issue. And I didn't quite know what was the confusion, because I was very clear about what I was saying. I think Swami was very clear, and so were Moin El Haq and Abu Bakr. So I wasn't quite sure what that was about. But I would say that the discussion that was going on with us, the two men, Abu Bakr, Moin El Haq, and Swami and myself, some of the issues that were being raised about why rapes occur, what was, and the victimization of the woman, which I took offense at. It's like, I think it's such an archaic notion, and yet we're discussing that today, that because a woman dresses in a certain way, she's opening herself to rape. And I think in one of my letters I said, we are discussing this even as this rape occurred in India, and I don't know that there was much response locally to the rape. And one of the horrible things following that, the case is going on right now, is that the lawyer for the defense and the lawyers for defending, who defend rapists, always bring forward this thing that the woman was looking for it. She wasn't dressed properly. And they talked about this girl on the bus and she was out late. And the lawyer has said something to the effect that women who dress decently don't get raped. You know, so I that kind of notion that the woman is asking to be raped. The fact that we're still
blaming the victim,
I think is just, but it happens, it's not just Guyana, it happens everywhere.
Ms. Bissam?
Yes, I think, in the media, except for the letters, didn't see much, but I know that there was a level of discussion, among people at various levels, talking about this, because it really did touch upon people. I mean, the horror of what happened.
Yeah.
And I saw a lot on Facebook also. And in my work with church groups, in an informal way, yes, there was that discussion. And again,
but publicly, did the churches come out enough?
No. The churches did not, I would say, that did not come out.
I don't know whether they saw it as an Indian problem,
I didn't expect anything better.
Even from the women's organizations?
Sometimes what happens if you're in a woman's organization is that you're rendered speechless.
I think that's a statement, it's not good enough,
but you're rendered speechless. I mean, it's another one. It's a horrible one.
Tell the males out there why women should be rendered speechless in perhaps the most damaging, destroying, destructive abuse a woman can suffer at the hand of a man. Are we putting it man on woman rape indeed?
One of the things that, you know, the Abu Bakr that lives in France, I gather there are two, he wrote after Ryan and Zahn and said that, you know, we should not import things into Guyana. There's no misogyny here.
I know.
You know, and so on.
Yeah.
Look, the thing that horrifies you the most, I suppose as a woman, but it should be as a person, is the degree of viciousness that is engaged in the rape itself, in the literal...
Are we talking generally now? We're not talking about the 23-year-old woman.
Generally. Mm-hmm. My response to that had precisely to do with when I saw that what turned out to be a relatively young boy had pushed a piece of metal up inside her and turned it around until her organs were destroyed. Mm-hmm. You know, that is the stage at which what is there to say? And it's kind of amazing how often it is true in rape that they use other things, sometimes a gun, if they have a gun, sticks, bottles, whatever, and so on. And so the part of the rape that involves the human body is followed up by the use of these implements, which could have no purpose except destruction. There's nothing else you could be doing with that.
You've heard, if you've seen any of the debates, if you've heard them, you read the letters. Do you think men truly understand, and men can understand, the horror of rape? We can speak very dispassionately, almost intellectually about it. Do you think they can?
I think that some men seem to be sensitive to it, but I think on the whole, I don't think men truly understand how horrible it is to take a woman against her will and to force himself. The fact that one of the reasons they're giving that a man can say she was looking for it, right? To me, it is saying to me, now what does it say about him as a man that he has to force himself on a woman to have sex, right? That he maybe can't, I don't know, there are all kinds of psychological reasons why they do it. But the violence of the thing that you are going, because rapes happen with a brute, they have to hold the woman down, you know, stop her from screaming, probably have a knife to her throat. So it's a violent act, and then the intrusion into the actual, literal penetration of the woman's body against her will. I mean, it's a most violent thing. But you know what? Since I've been back, I listen, there's a parlance, there's the common language that is used here. And I have heard, and it always jars in my ear, that, you know, you talk to the people on the streets and think that this is like how the people talk among themselves, right? And I've heard so many men talk about women, right? They say, yeah, you know, and he tech the woman, right? And the women too talk like that among themselves, that he tech me. So this is how the man speaks of a relationship with a woman, that he tech the woman. And it's when you listen to the language, it's a language of control, it's a language of ownership, and whether we are aware of it or not, that it's what the relationship is about, that the man takes the woman as property, that he has control over this woman, and that the women too talk like that too. They say, well, you know, the man take me, right?
I would say that at one level, in terms of the understanding about the violation and the destruction, I think that is understood, because that's intent. when a man rapes a woman. So in terms of understanding the kind of violation to human being that's being done, and it's done in a framework where a man feels that he has a power to
do
this.
But I'm not talking about a man, I'm talking about the whole discussion, the debate. When we talk, we're just intellectualizing. Mm. We truly understand the sheer horror, the brutality of this.
It depends on if you've ever been in a position of absolute powerlessness, then you might get it. Mm. Right? Mm-hmm. Because it is that. It is for that period of time, however long or short it is, the sense that you have no power to defend yourself, you know, as a person against this, what is usually, Ryhan is right, what is usually a gang of them. That feeling of powerlessness, I don't think you could possibly understand if you've never been there. And as a friend of mine once said, if you're a woman, even if you've never been raped, there's a way that you do understand it, because as a woman, girl growing up, and so you live your whole life being told, you know, to protect yourself against the possibility of being attacked, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So that, you know, so it's not unfamiliar.
The fact that Swami Acharyananda brought the thing up, I mean, he's a man, right? And I think he does. I say some men understand the horror of what happens. But talking about one of the things, and I mentioned it in my letter, one of my letters, that when men are bringing forward the, you know, okay, she dressed in a certain way, and she dressed immodestly, and she walk in late at night, and so the woman then is blamed for allowing herself, opening herself to rape. But I think... The question of that men do this, fine. But what I find even more horrible is that women agree with that. There are women who would stay,
Is it because of that acculturation? They've just been accustomed, they've been conditioned to think they're subservient, that that's their place.
No, I'm saying that there are women in the society who would agree with the men. That yes, she dressed right, and yes, she walking late at night, and what she opened herself, and what she down the road for.
Because
and
I think that we've been co-opted into this whole ideology and framework of patriarchy, where we do agree with that hierarchy of relationships, and that we live in a certain order where, you know, there's that kind of dominance, and where women are to be controlled at every level, including, you know, where she goes, how she dresses, what she does, how she carries, you know, everything about her is to be controlled. And so yes, in terms of many women have been co-opted into this way of thinking, and so the condemnation in terms of dress, in terms of looking at the survivor rather than looking at the predator, you know, there's so much more in
but
terms
I think,
of the victim.
I think, and I will stop you, that the fact that a woman cannot have empathy with another woman to say that if it happened to her, it can happen to me. And that alone should be an empathy where you can say that you can support the woman's, you know, to say that she had no right to be. No, I don't care how a woman dresses, how she walks, how late it is. No man has the right. No man has the right to rape a woman.
I don't think there's any question that, I mean, you know, you live in the world as it is. And some people manage to break past that, you know, to think other things and imagine other things and so on. But the vast majority of people are shaped by the ideas around them, the culture around them and so on. And so, yes, it is women are shaped in the same culture that men are shaped in. And therefore, it is sadly but inevitably very often true that women see things no differently from men do. One of the things that is always most upsetting, if you go like to court and so on, is to watch the mother and the neighbor and the son of the male, of the criminal male and so on, and the venom that they will turn on the victim, in defense of the man and so on. But having said all of that, I know that you're not going to carry us down the road now of blaming the woman.
Oh, I'm asking questions. Now, this question of rape has been associated with wars. It's been part of the booty of war. in which the main religions have been associated over the centuries. To what extent do you get a sense that the religions are prepared to accept, look, we have helped to contribute to this mindset?
I think major religions are complicit in this and need to acknowledge any kind of complicity in terms of perpetuating this kind of dominant power relationship, and also about women's bodies being properties. And therefore, there's that sense of complicity, and so not speaking out, like in Guyana, in terms of, talking about the Christian community, not speaking out, it becomes one. Maybe I think there's an element of speechlessness, yes, but also the inability to be able to come together to make statements and to say something about these horrors, although people will acknowledge this kind of horror. But it is true that the history of major religions, and certainly Christianity, has been one, you know, where there are horrible stories of rape in the Bible also.
Mm-hmm. And there's this issue of the Catholic Church and these little boys. So
yes.
that's a form of rape as well, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes, oh, yeah, definitely.
It is.
Yeah. Yeah, but you're
a Muslim, are you? Mm-hmm. The Muslim's position on rape and women.
Well, I don't think any religion, worth its salt, would say that it's okay to rape a woman. I don't think anybody would say that. But I think it goes further to how women are viewed, and all the religions. You talk about Christianity, Hinduism, Judaism, or Islam. It's all the major religions. They all were created, Hinduism way back in ancient times, and the three Middle Eastern religions came about in medieval times. Mm. And there are a lot of anachronisms, like you say, in the Bible, in the Quran, you would find that. You would find Bhagavad Gita, Ramayana, and all of that, and in Judaism as well. Mm. So, and I think it's a problem when you start to have literal, when you start to take the word literally, and you're unable to kind of say that, okay, we live in a different time. Christianity has managed to modernize itself. It speaks now from the pulpit, you have women priests and you have homosexual priests.
Not in the Catholic religion, though.
Right. Well, okay. So you have, you know, but Hinduism, they've always had pandits and panditas, so the women had status in that sense. You have swamis and swaminis, but Judaism.
But in
Islam,
terms of numbers, though, the swamis.
Well, it's
are
probably
far
smaller. Yes, it's probably smaller. But like Judaism and Islam, there is no sort of priesthood where women are part of that, and I'm hoping that that's part of what needs to be done to bring these kinds of religions into more modern kind of.
On the question of religion, Andaiye.
I always feel very tentative. Pat, protect me. I don't mean against Ryhan. I mean against whoever is looking. No, I'm not a religious person. That's why I said that. I'm not anti-religious either. I think that there are things that, in a way, that I absolutely had not understood until not very many years ago. There are simply things that human beings feel so strongly about or can be so manipulated about that it is as if it carries them past reason. And sometimes religion is one, just as sometimes...
Carries them beyond reason.
Beyond reason, yes. Mm-hmm. Sometimes race is one. Mm-hmm. Sometimes tribe is one, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And what...
Sometimes gender might be one as well. Mm-hmm.
We will see. I'm not sure that works in the same group and collective way. Mm-hmm. Because the things that you see people doing in the name of religion or race or tribe are not things that any of them would say sitting in a room are reasonable things to do, right? But when they get into a collective, especially if they're being whipped up and so on, it really does carry them somewhere where the most inhuman kinds of behavior can seem like, you know, what you have to do. And yes, I'm sorry, I was just going to say, of course, in that sense, everybody is complicit, but you have to say that religious forces are particularly complicit because of what they claim they are. And what they claim they are means that they, if anybody, ought to do a better job than they do.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that she brought up the point that's part of it, religion being part of it, politics, because you have wars, people against people, whether it's religion, whether it's race, whether it's not, and the humiliation, the part of the conflict becomes I'm going to empower and humiliate.
It's part,
and
yeah.
Right, and it's always been part of the baggage of war. That you rape the women, and we talk about it, Bosnia, Africa, whatever, but it happens here. And the WISMA report of 1963 talked about that happened in WISMA. The gift report of Ghana Indian Foundation Trust post-98 elections talked about women being stripped in the streets and raped in Georgetown. And our report of 2002, we have similar instances. We've dealt with rapes, and this women who came forward to talk about their stories. And this girl, Rohini, she and her relative was on New Garden Street, and they were surrounded by men and women. And the men told the women that they were going to rape them. And Rohini curled herself into a fetal position with her knees to her stomach to try and protect herself. They held her down, right? The men continued to terrorize the women by trying to unzip their jeans, and they cried out in fear and prayed, while another group of men and women mocked and taunted them.
So you're showing that as part of the politics
and, race.
Just to say that, we have to remember that all of these, in terms of conquest, I mean, religion as a means and an instrument of conquest, also in terms of the same political conquest, where women are actually...
But what was...
Let me finish, please, yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes, where women then, their bodies come as a very important tool for those conquerors to kind of show that, they have managed to ravage.
Yeah.
And this is how they show it.
It's
widely publicly displayed.
It's actually meant to be a humiliation.
Yeah, it's
a
humiliation.
But, yes, but for the man, exactly.
The other factor involved here is that women were also there.
Yes.
Yeah. Women were...
Which is the race issue.
Yes,
and I said
it. Mm. Yeah. The women were trying, in another girl, Savitri, said women were trying to get her trousers off to prepare her for the rape, So the horror happens right here on our doorstep.
Now, in the series, Bishop Alain, the Roman Catholic bishop, explained the restriction against women being ordained as historical, that the priest is the Christ figure. He did say that in time, he hopes it soon, women will be ordained in the Catholic Church. The Muslim leader explained it as... accountable to a woman's menstruation, which makes her indisposed to carry out certain functions.
Not to mention which every man was swimming in.
I know, I just find that.
Including Jesus Christ. Anyway, sorry. Go ahead.
Sometimes words just fail you.
Yeah, exactly.
This
not you, words have never failed.
I have an old joke in relation to this, Christ. Why women can't be, and so on. Several years ago, some women were agitating for Anglican women to be priests or whatever they're called, and so on. And whether it is true or not, it was reported that Bishop George said that the disciples were all male. There were no women disciples. And I sent to ask him whether there were any Guyanese ones. Rather absurd.
Absolutely.
Yes. Absurd. The menstruation thing, I always want to ask them whether, if you're a woman, you can come back when you get postmenopausal.
Oh, yes.
No, but this thing about the uncleanliness and impurity is a very archaic medieval notion again. And when I'm talking about bringing these religions into modern times, part of that is that they probably they didn't understand what was going on in a woman's body, what was happening. And so they had, and of course, they are patriarchal religions. So the thing about controlling the woman and thing again, it comes back.
And it's also being selective of what text and what they use, because if they go through those kind of rules that he'll be referring to, I think everyone will be disqualified, because they fail to also recognize all the texts that say we're all created in God's image, or that at one stage stage. I mean, there was slave obey your masters. Another stage there's slave nor free, women or men, Jew nor Gentile. So people are very selective in terms of how they want to justify these positions of power.
But I still find it absurd that, you know, Christianity came out of the context of that same Middle Eastern thing. And they have managed, like I'm saying, they have managed to get their women.
I'm ordained, fully ordained.
She's a priest. So the fact that Judaism also and Islam needs, this is part of the process that they need to go through. I think with Hinduism, like I said, there is female pandits and female swamis. Mm-hmm. But I have heard, I don't know if you know about this part, but I have heard it said that when women have their periods, and if there's a puja, that they cannot touch the vessels and things. I don't know. I'm hearing this, but I'm not sure.
I think that is also, I mean, it's not so true now.
It may be more of a custom rather than a religious thing.
Yeah.
But, you know.
Before we take that break, alcohol is a contributor to violence. I think there's
years ago, during the Rodney days, one of my unfortunate duties, women always get these tasks, one of my unfortunate duties was to settle disputes. And half the time there were disputes, of course, between men and women. Yeah. And I remember this woman in Barbice saying something that was so true that I ended up writing a little poem off of it, that from Monday to Friday, he was the best husband she could want, mm-hmm. till he get you money and he drink you rum. And she talked about her lying there crying even before he came, because she knew how he would come. But the one thing I'd like to say, though, is that the impulse to beat or rape, I don't think, is as a result of the substance abuse. It is that the substance abuse removes whatever inhibition. You know, we all walk around the place controlling ourselves, otherwise life would be complete chaos, right? And it's that is removed when you have the alcohol or whatever it is. So you still have to deal with the fact that even if you ban the alcohol, there's still this other thing that finally we have to deal with, that feeling, that impulse, that dislike, that hatred, what is it, is there.
Mm-hmm. Before we take an break, any comment on it?
Yeah, I totally agree in terms of, you know, there's something more fundamental that we have to look at, though acknowledging that, yes, substance abuse, I mean, alcohol, these are, you know, highly contributing factors.
You know, the use of it to sort of explain away the crime is just not, you just don't accept that.
On Plain Talk this evening, I'm discussing rape from the woman's point of view. I'm speaking with Andaiye, Pat Bisnott, and Ryhan Shaw. We now take a brief break. Welcome back to Plain Talk with Andaiye, Pat Shiratan Bisnott, and Ryhan Shaw. We're discussing rape. We talked about power, rape being partly the result of this power and how we see power and use power. The question of the glass ceiling, you mentioned the patriarchal society. A man is in charge among the power structures, the government, the public service, the private sector. We talked about the religions already. How is it?
Well, the one of the things we think is that if you look in the whole of certainly the English-speaking Caribbean, women have the most extraordinary amount of responsibility for family care and child care. Women all over the world have responsibility for family care and child care. Ours is really large. And there used to be an old notion that we had only a relative handful of single-parent households, mother-headed and so, but that's not true anymore, partly because of migration. Now, the relevance
so
of that...
Even where there's a marriage...
Even where there's a marriage, the woman is a de facto single parent. The reason for starting that way is because you have all of this work that women do that is for no money. And the work that they do outside the home, if they are working class women, is the same work that they do inside the home for no money, and they do it outside for little money. Hence, domestic work, right? Well, these days, a kind of security guard work, which turns out to be domestic work. Even nurses and teachers and so on, all of those things that are called women's work are very badly paid, right? As compared to men's work. So whether you're talking about the private sector or the public sector, the fact is that women get less money than men do. If you're talking quickly about things like leadership and so on and so forth, well, you see our parliament, even though there are some of us who feel, some of us who fought for women to be one-third of the lists, wonder most days why we bothered, since the women are not any different from the men, usually. But we had to fight for that. We had to fight for them to be one-third of the list, and it's not even one-third of the parliamentarians. So within the political hierarchy as well, whatever they pretend, women are there in smaller numbers. We're there in smaller numbers on boards in terms of ownership of land, in terms of ownership of business, and all of those things. Anybody who says that these are matriarchal societies, in which women are superior to men and so on, really don't understand what they're talking about. They don't.
Yes, I think following on that, in terms of in the last decades, especially last two decades, we have seen women coming into positions of leadership and power, you know, in political sphere and elsewhere. But in terms of how that makes an impact in terms of bringing new eyes and new ways.
But I know you're saying it's not showing up out there.
No, she's saying it's better than it was 20 years ago.
But in terms of numbers, yes, in terms of visibility, in terms of the percentages, yes. But in terms of that kind of consciousness that women will be bringing to make an impact in terms of how, it's not just to see a woman sitting, I want to see a woman sitting there, but I also want to see a woman that has a consciousness of dealing with an issue differently in terms of a recognition of the kind of gender dynamics and in terms of how this affects women and men, especially recognizing that women are, you know, the poorer, more marginalized, more vulnerable part of the population. So that is still largely lacking. I mean, when Andaiye referred to like parliament and other facilities where you expect that this would be represent and bring to the floor, I mean, the real situation involving women and represent them there. In a lot of cases, this does not happen because, you know, there's that kind of leaving home or lack of consciousness, critically.
You're from the private sector. Give me a perspective on the private sector.
Take that and go for that. I want to take it from a cultural aspect of what is expected from women in our culture. And most times, all that is expected of women is that they get married, and they have a home, and that they have children, and that is it. They're not nurtured to think of themselves as going out there to become a corporate head, or that men are acculturated to that. Women, I don't know if that still, but I'm thinking back in the 50s and 60s, this was how women were seen, that okay, you will come out of school and you'll get your thing and you will get married and you will settle down. And that basically is it. My book, A Silent Life, is about that. It's the grandmother who went through trying to become somebody and she was shot down. And her granddaughter, two generations later, goes through the same thing. And basically her marriage broke up because why? She became more powerful. She got ahead in her career. And in a sense, the man was kind of lagging behind. And he, as the male, couldn't deal with that. So sometimes it's a matter that some women kind of hold themselves back because...
Are you blaming the women there?
Sometimes it is a matter that they do, because they don't want to rock the boat, because they see themselves in a certain way, that if they are to stay married, if they're to stay in the home, whatever, that this is what is expected. It's a terrible thing to say.
Do women hold themselves back?
Sometimes. I was thinking of a friend of mine called Nisha Hanif, a friend of ours actually, who was doing work on reproductive health and so on, and began from the assumption that she would see a big difference in the behavior and attitudes of Indo-Guyanese and Afro-Guyanese women, and was thoroughly amazed that in the end neither had autonomy within her relationship with the man that she was in.
Mm-hmm. Did they approach it differently from Nisha's research?
When you say approach differently, they ended up in exactly the same position. That is to say, was their behavior different? No, not really. Except I nearly called the girl's name. God, she would have killed me. Except that there was a difference in style. Mm. Style. But not in actual content of the relationship at all. So yes, but sometimes look, we're also full of women who it's not just even a question of choice. If you don't have enough money, mm-hmm. and if your access to money is via a man or men, then you do what is necessary in order to be able to get him, keep him, and get the money. So it's not. You know, here go these stupid women and so on. These are hard decisions that people feel forced to take.
Does this mean then that's the whole legal, legislative, sociological framework in fact discriminates in favor of the man and penalizes and subjugates the woman?
I wouldn't say that. Mm-hmm. I think the question of choice arises, and it is what a woman
No, but does she have the choice to get the same kind of job, the same kind of money, to exert the same kind of pressure to reach the same levels?
I think that choice also has to be seen within kind of societal expectations and in terms of many factors that she may have to deal with, that she has to deal with, which, you know, men, you know, have to deal with differently, which kind of...
Men don't have to.
They don't have to deal with it, exactly.
The woman often... And I've had discussions with this with male friends. And in the Indian culture, let's say, the woman often has to get out of this box in which the expectations of your role and what you're supposed to do, and to go out of the box. And that means sometimes...
She has to try harder than her male counterpart.
Right, and it also means that she may get flack for it, you know, that, you know.
I want to get back. Partly to the religious issue. We heard a Swami say on the program that he wasn't favorably disposed to working with the Muslims and the evangelicals because of this tendency to
conversion.
Poach and convert. Mm-hmm. Is that a good enough ground for not working on these kinds of issues, like rape?
You'd have to phrase it differently, because the...
Okay, you answer it.
No, I certainly, having grown up at a time when you had to be Christian to whatever, to go to school, to get job, to get whatever and so on, there is a bad history to this. I mean, it's not just that somebody stayed at home and thought, I don't want to do this. There's an extremely bad history to this. Yeah.
And it continues now.
Except if they are willing to give that up. Two things. They should say sorry for the past, but also they have to give it up in the presence and so on. Then I certainly understand why somebody would have difficulty putting themselves there. Although, on the other hand, I find it a pity because we have so many reasons to be disunited in this place that we live in, you know. So if we can't, the religions can't come together and the races can't come together, and, you know. If we could find a way to cross the divides in spite of these horrors and so on, we would be better off.
But which is the bigger horror?
But don't let's pretend that it's not a horror. And I heard those men. I thought that they were... Occasionally, they bordered on something like they sounded when I was a child.
Yeah, I didn't hear those men. But
as a bossy example.
Yes, in terms of conversion and this.
And working with everybody. Forget, you know, where do you place your emphasis? Do you say, look, this is such a big issue that I feel so strongly about. It's so horrible.
Yeah, I think we need really, I mean, in terms of an issue like this, if we really agree and we feel a horror of the situation, definitely in terms of crossing those barriers to be able to unite, you know, to be able to form, you know, larger forces against this. I mean, it's really very important. You know, I hear where Swami's coming from, and I do understand, because as Andaiye said, you know, there's a history and there's still an ongoing struggle in terms of, you know, the division and in terms of conflicts. Conflicts may be too strong a word, or maybe not, in Guyana. But in terms of looking at this horror of the situation and knowing that it's so important and it would make a difference if people across religions can come together to address it, I do believe that this needs to be examined again.
Sorry, Ryan. No, just one thanks. I have to say this carefully so as not to seem to be knocking any religion, but you know, it's not only the history and so on, and even the thing about conversion in the present, but some of the attitudes they have, some of the religions have to women, that they will bring into this thing that you are talking about, are not going to be very useful.
Yeah,
I mean, it's one of the reasons why I'm not all that gung-ho about the religious groups uniting and making a bigger impact and so on, is because some of it is just plain backward.
Yeah,
some of it meaning some.
Some of what they believe, some of what they want to propose. As
if I can just jump in there to say a little thing, because yes, it is very true in terms of in terms of taking a step back to look at coming together. I have heard from some religious, and let me stick with the Christians in terms of reinforcing that. That patriarchal, that male authority in the home, head of home, that if you are to have this in the sequence, and if women are to obey and follow that, then it means less violence.
No, perfect harmony.
Yes.
Yes. So, one has to take into consideration that this is no way that I would unite with people who speak and interpret scriptures as such.
The thing is, you probably have, if you have a forum, then you get rid of the minor issues and go ahead with, you know, hopefully what you can. But when you're talking of religious leaders, you see, right away, you're talking of men.
Which is not.
So where do we come into that equation of having a say at that table? Okay, people like Pat, who is a priest, can probably be there. But what about some of the other religions?
Well, what I can tell you I will do, I will share a copy of the recording of this program with each of the religious leaders. And this is why I'm asking you to speak plainly.
And because talking about backwardness and stuff, we're still talking about Islam and whatnot as being at where some of the religious leaders, or most of the religious leaders in this country, would read the Quran and the Hadith. There are these thousands of Hadiths which are interpretations, in a literal sense.
Right, same.
Yeah. And that is where I have a lot of problems. You know, you're talking of something that happened back in the 4th and 5th century.
So on this question of four wives.
I talked about it, that it was part of the thing at the time.
But is it acceptable now?
No, I don't think so. And we're not living in an Islamic state or anything like that. But, and I talked about it in my letter, that right now it's seen as an abuse and a disease. At the time there were wars, there were less men around, and women were not educated, and they weren't independent. So they were being protected. You had to be kind of protected under a man.
I think Abu Bakr said that you were wrong.
One of the issues I raised during the program as well, this was wider outside of the concept of rape, LGBT. lesbian, gay, bisexual, transvestite. The two of the religions seem to have taken a fairly open approach to it. What's your view, and Pat, your pastor yourself, how do you feel about this? And maybe I can start with you on this issue.
I think that it's been a very difficult issue for the Christian community and others too. But
Obama said it's a human rights issue.
It's a human rights issue. I think in terms of some churches talking about this as a human rights issue in terms of fundamental human rights, they've managed to advance the discussion in some places. However, there has been quite, and I would say, an infiltration of thinking in terms of theological thinking, especially from some parts of North America, in terms of you know, very right wing thinking that pushes the discussion in terms of an abomination. I think what is really an abomination is the way that the homophobic situation in Guyana perpetrated by the churches. This is really an abomination, and so I think we have room to advance and to move further if we would look at this, if we would look at the fundamentals of what we are talking about here in terms of sexual violence.
You know, I was hoping that issue would have divided us, but
absolutely. Well, I mean, you know, there are people who are heterosexual, and there are people who are homosexual, and there are people who are bisexual, and there are people who are transgender. You know, it really is not about who is moral and who is sinful, and especially when you are talking about human behavior that hurts nobody except to hurt you because you decide to mind the people's business and so on. There are all kinds of things in this society for them to fight up about that hurt other people. Let them look, it is just wrong and out of order. Yeah. Right?
Totally. Well, I take a very liberal view.
You take a very liberal view.
I don't know what the man Islam said, but I have no problem.
Well, you know what the Quran says about it.
What does the Quran say?
I thought you did.
There's nothing in the Quran that says anything about
it. Doesn't speak about it.
They don't talk about anything like that. People think all these guys were talking, these things that are quoting from the Quran. The Quran doesn't even go into anything like that. But it's a situation where we should be tolerant. If I don't have a problem, as long as you don't come into my space and tell me you have to be like this, you know, everybody should be tolerant and everybody should be respectful.
Rape is part of this wider evil of violence. Do we have too much? Is that the root of the problem?
What? The wider problem?
The wider problem of violence.
I don't know. To me, the root of the problem is the question of power. Because one of the things that we didn't have time to talk about is there's an article that's very good by Arundhati Roy, in which she says that what happened in India was absolutely dreadful, to be condemned and so on. But she said, every day in India, and I could add every day everywhere else as well, there are powerful men who commit rape against women with far less power, and not a man move. Nothing is said whatsoever. And in relation to India, she was talking in particular places like Chhattisgarh and so on, and Dalits and tribal women and so. Okay? Mm-hmm. So if you look at all the variety of reasons people have to rape, you have the religious war, the this war, the that war, the undeclared war, the class war, the undeclared war, I mean the one that goes on every day and so on and so forth. Then to me, what is common to all of those things is not any human propensity to violence. It is about the propensity to dominate and to exercise power. And one last thing there. There's a book by Danzen Shipprasad on domestic violence. And I was always fascinated by what they said. They said that in Indo-Guyanese families, men beat to retain power. And in Afro-Guyanese families, they beat to regain power. And you have to wonder whether the beating feels any different, depending
to
on
to
the woman, right?
Do we have too much violence in our society?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Definitely. And the question of rape within that. Yeah, but I don't think we have the statistics on what? Murders, how many murders happen. And even probably women come forward and say they were beaten. But I can sit here and think about 12 things that I know about abuse, child molestation, sexual harassment in the workplace, which are never, people don't talk about. We still, women don't come forward, they don't bring these issues to the fore because there's the shame factor, there's guilt involved, there's all kinds of other things involved. So we really do not know. The statistics on rape are, or the statistics on abuse, you're never, I think it's just the tip of the iceberg. So there is the violence that we know about, and there is all these underbelly violence that you never hear about, and that women suffer quietly and families take care of things quietly, because we do not have a system in Guyana. We do not have a system where if something happens to any one of us, we can go to a police station, right? And report a rape that a police knows, one, how to deal with it, that they have, we don't have any police force that knows
how to deal. Is it also true that sometimes families keep it quiet?
Yes.
For example, the incest.
Because
father-child, right. Incest.
And that happens. It happens.
Yeah.
And
like, for instance.
Because there's a lot of shame involved. Mm-hmm. And I think part of it is because we do not have support systems. We do not have supportive institutional systems that you can come forward and say, look, this is what is happening, and that it will be dealt with competently and in an effective manner.
Mm-hmm. Andaiye, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, sorry, I realize that somewhere there's Benita Harris, and if she's looking at this program, she's going to kill me, that you asked a question about violence, and I didn't say anything about violence against children. Because of course that's where the whole thing starts. This thing that we insist on calling corporal punishment, which allows people to say, you know, that I beat it till his skin run and
beat
so on and so forth. Yes, we beat sense.
And
I remember one time there was a public debate about this, and one really quite ridiculous and unreasonable man had the gall to say that he was the living proof that beating works. Right,
because that, yeah.
but the truth is that what we do is to teach on reason. On reason.
Yeah. I've got about 4 minutes.
Right.
Some solutions. What can we do? What can we tell some of these religious leaders? What can we tell families? Tell the politicians, the captains of industry. What can we do?
I don't know.
There is one solution. Like I said, you can have a Sexual Offences Act, right? And we can all go home and sleep night. Oh, we got a Sexual Offences Act and whatever. We do not have these institutions where people can go and get safe haven and understanding, that a woman can come forward and say, I have been raped, and she has the police force or police service who will have them go to court and have an enabling environment where the lawyer for the rapist will not come forward and say she caused the rape. And then we have the court of public opinion where we still are saying, and women are saying this too, that she brought it on herself. Mm-hmm. So I think the solution has to be wide-ranging. There has to be education. We have to start talking about it. Probably talking about it more helps. But I think if you are able to get them to not just the Sexual Offences Act, which I think is correct, but you have to have the institutions, you have to have trained people, police force, the psychologists, whoever, to deal with the situations effectively. If not, nobody's coming forward.
In addition to that, because I agree,
from
we need
the religious perspective.
Yeah, religious and others. I think that we also need more coalition around this. You know, like there was this coalition for HIV and AIDS. I mean, we've seen a decline in terms of the prevalence and all of it. But I think there's not enough of a coalition, you know, the all kinds of sector, the business sector, although, you know, what we may find in there. But still, we need broad coalitions. And in terms of religious organizations, not only coming forward, but also being accountable for what they teach and how they contribute to this whole mindset and in terms of, you know, how this manifests itself in kind of violence and relationships, including the corporal punishment, because they have been also been pushing, sparing the rod and spoiling the child, without realizing that we're still living, you know, with such a heavy slave mentality that we do believe that people have to be controlled by violence.
Hello?
Yeah, the first thing any coalition would have to do is to audit what is there, because in fact, a lot of work has been done, but it kind of dissipates, right? There's been more training of police. I'm not a great believer in this training, but there's been a lot of training of police and so on. But what it is that the efforts tend to be scattered. So that's one thing. I know we don't have any time, so let me just knock the lawyers here before I have to shut up. A woman in the UK just killed herself because of the trauma of giving testimony against her rapist in the face of a defense lawyer who destroyed her in order to get his client off. If you want to put together all the various pieces and so on, one of the big problems is that women do not wish to go to court and to have that happen to them.
So the judicial system are still allowing that defense. That's what I don't understand. They're still allowing lawyers to come forward and to put the victim on trial.
And one thing I must say, because this is a focus for me now in terms of working with men and promoting positive masculinity, I think there needs to be a re-examination of what it means to be a man, what is manhood, and this needs to be widely done with men's networks and all of that.
On Plain Talk this evening, I've been discussing a issue of rape from the perspective of women with social activist Andaiye, Pastor Pat Shiratan Bisnot, and businesswoman Ryhan Shaw. I'll see you next week when I have Mr. Roald Johnson, writer on the Caribbean Press and literature generally. Thank you very much. Good night.